This isn't a fucking conspiracy. This is real life, and people are fucking dying.
Welcome to No Way Jose. You can find us on YouTube, all the major auto podcatchers, and Rumble as well. That banger was from one of my sponsors, one of my Patreon sponsors, Jolyon Klebold. He's been on here on the show quite a few times too. Today, as you guys can see by the title, part five of what really happened in Watergate. I think this is probably going to be the last one. This is where we're going to really get to the penultimate what the fuck we've been hinting at this entire time. I guess kind of the theory, the rough theory, you can take it or leave it, but I don't know. I think there's, even if it isn't exactly applicable here, there are things to be thought about after. But yeah, I do want to, before we get into it, let you guys know that today's episode is brought to you by our friends over at Nadeau Shave Co. If you're tired of that razor burn irritation, those ingrown hairs that you can get from those multi-blade cartridges, and these are your guys. Return to the traditional shave. You don't need the expensive nonsense. This is high-quality stuff. You can shave like your grandpa used to. Whether you're shaving your entire face or just edging up your beard, the single blades give you a barber-grade shave for a fraction of the price. So upgrade your shaving system. The standard issue includes one traditional safety razor and a box of 100 stainless steel razor blades. This is $75, was what that costs. It allows you to shave for about an entire year, but to be real, most everyone I talk to lasts a lot longer. I guess it depends on how much you do it. But if you're one of those people who shaves on the regular, you may want to consider signing up for the Quarter Shave Club. That's only 25 cents per replacement blade. They've also got a shave lather now. They've got like a 3-in-1 and a shave soap. I've used a 3-in-1. It's a good stuff. It's a body wash, shampoo, and shave. It was good stuff. It really smelled good. Really, I don't know, felt clean, smelled clean, smelled manly. I liked it. It was good for shaving. So yeah, highly recommend that. I'll let you guys know when I try out the shave soap. But yeah, go to NadeauShaveCo.com, use Jose at checkout. With that, guys, let's go ahead and get into our show and get our guest on here, Austin, who's also my co-host on our live show, Already Dead. We do that every week at 9:30 Eastern on Tuesdays. Every now and then we might change up the date, but we try to let you guys know. But generally speaking, if you pop in on either me or Austin's YouTube or my Rumble channel, you'll see a live stream at that time for it. So, but it's a pleasure having you back, bud. Just saw you a couple days ago, and here we are again. Such is the way with us.
My God, man. I got some crazy notes for Tuesday already. It's been nuts. But anyway, I wanted to start off real quick and mention that last week I had ended the episode by first saying it correctly in Eugenio Martinez's perspective of the break-in, how McCord was among the five who were arrested that night at the Watergate complex. But he was the highest ranking officer at the time. So he was the one telling all, you know, the three Cubans and Frank Sturgis to keep their mouths shut and everything would be okay. He would take care of it. Meanwhile, you have Howard Hunt going across to the hotel where they have the wiretap monitor, Alfred Baldwin behaving as the spotter on duty at Howard Johnson's hotel across the street. And the official narrative is that he was distracted watching this film Attack of the Puppet. It was Attack of the Puppet People on TV. And it did not observe the arrival of the police car in front of the Watergate building. But I've heard this story told different ways. So it's interesting because what he testified seemed to be different than this. And but yet this is still the official narrative, which I find absolutely insane. But so nor did he see the plainclothes officers investigating the DNC sixth floor suite of 29 offices. And by the time Baldwin finally noticed any sort of unusual activity on the sixth floor and radioed the burglars, if you remember what Eugenio had said, he said that McCord instructed them to turn off their walkies so they had no comms. And so when the plainclothes officers, who among them, the three of them were Carl Schaffler, who we'll get into very soon, because he is a key part of all of this. Again, I've said it multiple times. I think that he is, you know, holds dual loyalty to military and intelligence and isn't only just a Washington, D.C. Metro Police, you know. So anyway, so by the time he radios to them, it's already too late anyway. And so the police apprehend the five men who are later identified as Virgilio Gonzalez, Bernard Barker, James McCord, Eugenio Martinez, and Frank Sturgis, all Op 40. Right. And by the way, the brainchild of it all that they claim ordered the break or was among the key individuals of like two to three people who were in on ordering the break in. He wasn't even there. Right. G. Gordon Liddy. And he's the only one who's not former CIA. He's former FBI. He's kind of fiercely loyal to the White House at this time. So he was really inevitably duped by McCord ultimately, because he was under the impression they were honestly going to break into the Watergate to bug Larry O'Brien's desk, which was the DNC. You know, I mean, it made sense as far as in his mind, because it's political dirt on your opponents. And so for him, that really kind of, he didn't even ask twice. That was what he expected them to have done. And he even testified to that. And so it's interesting that very night, and we'll get into, there's this small story about how Douglas Caddy, the attorney who was originally notified by Howard Hunt at fucking 3 a.m., he gets a call. He happens to be personal. He's not even a criminal attorney, Jose. It's crazy, man. Not even that. He happens to work for Mullen and Company, the company that has the CIA cover contract that is employing Howard Hunt during this fucking very moment when he's infiltrating the White House to perform this operation. And so when G. Gordon Liddy gets a call from Howard Hunt after he calls up Douglas Caddy, his personal friend and attorney, goes to his apartment at 3 a.m. And they inevitably call up G. Gordon Liddy and break the news to him. And he supposedly turned to his wife and said, "I'm going to fucking prison. Like, I'm fucked." Right? Like, he just knew immediately that. And Howard, by the way, he said personally that he knows it was a setup. This was a setup. That's what he said from the very first moment. And Frank Sturgis said the exact same thing. This was out and out a setup. And so, oh man, it's kind of nuts. But so they're all criminally charged with attempted burglary and attempted interception of telephone and other comms and the Washington Post, of course, right? Taking the lead, right? Running the official narrative for the deep state, it seems.
They've never done that before. Weren't they one of the major like Mockingbird networks or whatever? I forget. Right, yeah. Right.
They're literally the Mockingbird. The Washington Post, the CIA's voice box. That's what it really is. I mean, in all honesty. And so they report the day after the burglary that police found lockpicks and door jimmies, almost $2,300 in cash, most of it in $100 bills with serial numbers in sequence. Remember I said sequential? So a short wave, which to me, like I said, in a past episode, it really is implicating operational money, you know, that and so as if it's been sourced from the agency. And And that's honestly what it seems to be. And
I think we mentioned in a previous episode, and someone was mentioning that I heard, saw comments. Maybe they're just people coping for the deep state. But I did see comments that were like, that they will sometimes, you can get them from the bank just straight up.
Oh,
like
you can.
That.
You, yeah. So, but like, also, you could easily use that same argument to implicate the CRP and say that the committee to reelect the president, the independent agency within the White House that's running these operations for Gemstone, remember, you know, you could just as easily claim that it was sequential in order due to operational money from the CRP. So, I mean, it really doesn't make much of a difference, in my opinion. You know?
Well, the point being is, like, someone could just have just got it from the bank, the money. I don't know. I don't know how big of a deal. Like, I don't know it could be something that, like, implies that, or like if someone was setting it up, but I don't know if
the
it's
the problem is, I think, how much cash can you withdraw at a certain time, right? I think I'm not sure what the laws were at the time.
I don't think I would pull more than like 10K, or I don't even know if I've pulled that much. Out,
right, but. Right. Yeah, but anyway, it could very well be a non-starter, and it's not even the crux of any sort of argument at all. So it doesn't really even matter.
I only bring it up because a couple people brought up in the comments when we mentioned it before. So I'm like, funny. Fair enough, whatever. Because sometimes we have these like, I don't know how big of a deal it is, and then we'll get comments or like, it's not that big of a deal, or that is a big of a deal. So I do appreciate you guys' comments. I do see them. I'm really bad about replying, but I usually try to give you a lot of likes, so you know I see him when you leave his comments. I appreciate it. It usually is most of the time the comments are the people like, oh, great show, or it is like pointing out some minor complaints.
Right. That makes sense.
Which, makes whatever.
Sense. No, I had fair somebody enough. Just, yeah, usually it's people just saying how much they enjoyed it, or it's one person who notices one thing or that they might disagree with or have some sort of argument about. Like I just had with my process church episode, somebody pushed back on that Abraxas connection, and I'm just like, buddy, just go read it. All right, look what they discovered when they raided the property. All right, it's a coincidence they have two human skulls and all this jars of blood. It's like, brother, you know. But anyway, human blood, but it's okay. Yeah. So anyway, a shortwave receiver is also.
I do appreciate your comments. Just saying that.
Oh yeah, I'm not talking shit. I'm sorry.
What do you have? Like, some people do point out stuff. I'm like, oh shit, good. That's good stuff. Every now and then people are being annoying and pedantic, but that's rare. True. Yeah.
No, many times I've been corrected and they're 100% accurate. So it's, you know, I'm open to it always. But so among this cash that was discovered amongst, you know, when they were arrested, was also this shortwave receiver that could pick up police calls, 40 rolls of unexposed film, 2 35mm cameras, and 3 pin-sized tear gas guns. And the Post later reported that the actual amount of cash was like $5,300. And that's just the official report from, it looks like, Washington Post. So, yeah. Anyway, the following morning, June 18th, it's a Sunday, G. Gordon Liddy called Jeb Magruder in L.A., who's the deputy director of the CRP at this time, and informed him that the 4 men arrested with McCord were Cuban freedom fighters, right, who Howard Hunt had recruited. And initially, Nixon, of course, immediately went in with, first of all, John Dean, as his White House advisor, was running the cover-up for Nixon. And on the tapes, it's really honestly insane, because all of the examples of obstruction present on the audio, the White House tapes, dude, they all come from the advice of John Dean, right? And I was just like, oh my God. Like, especially when you find out Dean and Magruder are responsible for, Howard Hunt had these operational notebooks that only CIA operatives keep, only when they're on a mission, only when they're actively in the field. It's fucking insane. Like, I didn't know about this, but they have these specific, I forget, Aramay's notebooks or whatever, and these specific way that they utilize them for the operational diary. And they go missing when Howard Hunt decides to start blackmailing Nixon and kind of steps out of line, because he initially, along with McCord, they were banking on what they called they were anticipating their own CIA defense is basically what they were anticipating. So even McCord himself, he was so open to playing ball, and he inevitably did, but he just assumed that he would, like, it's on the record, he whispered to the judge when the judge asked him what agency he had belonged to prior to this. He goes, CIA. Like, it's fucking crazy, man. Like, that story is so ridiculous to me. But so, yeah, you find out that there's a safe that Hunt had in his office. Mm-hmm. And as soon as all this happens, and Hunt decides that he's going to... he basically, the war between, and St. John Hunt, Howard Hunt's son, he describes this time after Hunt gets arrested, approaching the trial. He refers to this period of time as Hunt's war on Nixon, basically, right? Or the Hunt Nixon wars is what he calls them. And yeah, it devastated their family personally. I mean, it really did. It's an insane story when you find out about what happened to Dorothy, his wife, and you realize that she was, I had mentioned before, she was OSS, you know, she was CIA, but precursor to that, and was stationed in like Shanghai, China. It was like post-World War II as well, where she met Howard Hunt in Averill Harriman's office. Mm-hmm. The offices of Averill Harriman. Yeah, you find out Averill Harriman. All right, he's a member of the Skull and Bones and a friend of the Bush family, deeply involved in the JFK assassination. And if you look up his family, it's pretty extraordinary that those connections there. But she was working out of his offices, allegedly tracking down Nazi gold, or, you know, Jewish gold, Nazi treasure, you know. Yeah. So after the war, she worked for the CIA in Paris, and there's an article, it's very brief, on Spartacus Educational that like really perfectly outlines her connections to Watergate and how this all just, there is absolutely no coincidence involved when it comes to her story. And really, it's amazing how if you weren't alive at the time and you weren't fully invested in the moment at the time, it was lost to, you know what I mean? And that story is I've never really seen it told often, especially in context of Watergate. And that makes no sense to me, because if anything, it points to the fact that Hunt was leveraging certain, first of all, I think that, and I'll make this case, that they had actual evidence that they had acquired that was potentially about the JFK assassination that was being housed at the Watergate complex at this time. And because they had also been breaking into the Chilean embassy, all this other stuff, they were breaking into they had a plan to break into the McGovern headquarters, had all these different black bag ops going on at the time. But so anyway, she meets Howard Hunt in Shanghai and then works in Paris for the CIA after the war. And was acting as a liaison between the American Embassy and the Economic Cooperation Administration, which was a CIA front company. And then the couple returned to the U.S. and settled in Bethesda, Maryland. And her husband spent much of his time involved, Howard, of course, in covert ops in Mexico, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Cuba, which we've mentioned, all the coup d'etats he was involved in. And so here's where the Watergate connections become very bold when it comes to her acting as a pay mistress for the original seven defendants.
And who was who was this again? The name? I forgot.
Oh, I'm
the name.
Sorry. Dorothy Wetzel, which Dorothy became Wetzel. Dorothy okay, okay. Hunt, right? Dorothy which Hunt, was yeah, Howard yeah. Hunt's wife and mother of his children, right? And okay. Yes, so she was heavily involved in the agency. And, you know, it's crazy. I mentioned St. John Hunt, Howard's son, and Dorothy's son, and he wrote a book actually about, I think it's called Dorothy, and he named it the amoral and dangerous woman, because that was literally the quote that Nixon and his advisors had in reference to Dorothy during this very time. And yeah, it's pretty insane. But so on the 3rd of July, 72, of course, Sturgis, Virgilio Gonzalez, Eugenio Martinez, Bernard Barker, and McCord were arrested while removing these devices from the DNC campaign offices in an apartment block. And so the phone number of E. Howard Hunt was found in address books of two of the burglars. That's how he was immediately implicated. And that's really how it was tied. Well, I think McCord would have already, you know, provided that direct connection to the White House, obviously. But that was,
you need some sort of post hoc connection.
Right. Right. Yeah, but so that was immediately how Howard was implicated in all of this, was because his phone number was found in the address book of two of the burglars. And I believe it's two of the Cubans. And
yeah, I feel like they're the especially when it's something like a huge deep event, it's always like this pre-hoc like rationalization, but they don't tell you what it is. And then later, if they have to, they will construct their own post hoc, like, oh, they here's this evidence, here's this passport, here's right. Like the pre-hoc would be like a what did they use in remote viewers? Like they used those in OKC to try to be like, oh, I think it might have been some fucking Middle Easterners. Like right off the bat, there was like a report that I think it was like a day or maybe it might have even been before it. I forget. It was like within days. Mm-hmm. And that was like what they used behind the scenes, because that's something they got FOIA'd later to be like, oh yeah, this is the remote viewer saw this. But it's like, I feel like if that what happens in real time is people go, we have intel that blah 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 blah, and then that intel is the remote viewing, and then while they're scrambling or something stupid like that, you know, that makes sense, and it's just kind of like, just take our word for it. So technically they like, it's like this kind of almost just like silly consent game, like, well, technically I'm telling the truth. Exactly. Technically, like, we do have intel. And then, you know, then after the fact, then they find a way to somehow have, oh, here's the evidence that actually shows that links them to this and this or whatever. Exactly, so, dude. Yeah, whether that's real evidence or not, that's not, seems to be how it works.
No doubt, man.
And then the official narrative later becomes, oh, we have this and this, and this is how we knew. And you're like, okay.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. I know that. And honestly, that seems to be the case a lot of the time. It's mm-hmm. very insane how often they tend to rely on anonymous, you know, it dude, and especially how they utilize it today, it's just mm-hmm. a joke, you know what I mean? But anyway, so
it is funny though, there is like almost this thing where it's like, it's almost like they feel like they can't lie to you, because it's like there's right. like the technically a truth.
Right.
No, like say with something like remote viewers. Yeah, we did have remote viewers that said this. Is it true? I don't fucking know. Like,
exactly.
Did I tell them, hey, you should that's see this? Did I taint point. The results somehow?
Exactly. Exactly. But that's what they do. It's a magic trick, right? Yeah. They put it out there, but
yeah, and then, like, technically, we never lied to you.
Exactly, dude. It's so just, like, just fucking, it's so just dishonest in reality. But, yeah, I don't know. I think it's crazy because you realize after all of this, man, like, McCord and Dean, they were running the cover-up for the CIA. I mean, that's what inevitably takes place. And especially when you find out, like, I had at least mentioned last episode how McCord really entered the I don't want to forget to get back and just finish this real quick with Dorothy Hunt, because I think it's an important thing for us to remember. So yeah, the phone number of E. Howard Hunt was discovered, and so the reporters were able to link the break-in to the White House. Now Bob Woodward, which is so great, but so yeah, then E. Howard Hunt threatened to reveal details of who paid him to organize the Watergate break-in. This is when Howard was constructing a CIA defense. And honestly, him and McCord both were under the impression at the beginning of all of this that the CIA would do what they typically do, which is infiltrate the legal counsel and basically just exercise their power and pull their agents out of the trial. That was essentially what they were hoping for. I forget the terms that they put it in, but it was basically that. It was kind of hilarious how they said it. But and Hunt even kind of hints to a lot of this, and it later acknowledges as much, basically because, like I said, they were anticipating this CIA defense. And before the agency decided otherwise, all right, McCord chose the side of the agency, is what it seems. And Hunt, of course, was left hung out to dry. And he even acknowledged that as much in his book. But yeah, so anyway, he threatens that he's going to expose who the key controllers are and the you know, who funded this operation. And Dorothy Hunt was then forced to kind of act on his behalf and took part in the negotiations with Charles Colson, who, if you remember, that's who Howard Hunt had gotten into contact with, who was the Brown alum that he was friends with personally. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, she's going into negotiations with him about this blackmail, basically. And according to this investigator named Sherman Skolnick, Hunt also had information on the assassination of John F. Kennedy. And he argued that if, quote, Nixon didn't pay heavy to suppress the documents they had showing he was implicated in the planning and carrying out by the FBI and the CIA of the political murder of President Kennedy, end quote. It's like, holy shit. So James McCord, he claims that Dorothy told him that at a meeting with her husband's attorney, William Buttman, she revealed that Hunt had information that would blow the White House out of the water. So that alone, right? You're legitimately threatening the White House at this moment, right? And so in October of 72, not long after everything has gone down, Dorothy attempts to speak with Colson again, and he refused to talk to her, but later admitted to the Times that she was upset at the interruption of payments from Nixon's associates to the Watergate defendants. So, yeah, according to at least St. John Hunt, from what he was expressing about this, he said that when his mom talked to Charles Colson, she was like, motherfucker, you better pay up. You better pay up. And we expect $1 million or we're going to fucking go public with this story right now. And I'm talking to this journalist named Michelle Clark, and we're going to tell all. And that's what they 100% were saying. And so on the 15th of November, Colson meets with Nixon, Haldeman, Ehrlichman, and they all go to Camp David and discuss Howard Hunt's blackmail threat. And Attorney General John Mitchell was also getting worried by Dorothy Hunt's threats, and he asked John Dean to use a secret White House fund to get the Hunt situation settled down. And this is on the tapes. You hear Dean is like convincing Nixon to spend whatever it takes. He's like, it's pretty extraordinary listening to those tapes, man. But I remember years ago, I listened to the JFK tapes for a little while. Mm-hmm. And that was like, they turn it into an audiobook file. It's not even that long, honestly, but it's really worth listening to because you hear these conversations that these people had no idea they were being taped, you know, and it's just, they show a side of themselves that's very revealing. You know what I mean? I think it's pretty special thing to witness, but anyway, so like I said, Attorney General John Mitchell, he's getting all worried about these threats. He tells John Dean to use this secret fund to get the Hunt situation settled down, is a quote. And eventually it was arranged for Frederick LaRue to give Hunt, who's an investigator, like a policeman, I believe just a detective, but he was tapped to give Hunt about $250,000 to buy a silence. But this wasn't the agreed upon amount, right? And so that's another thing, is that they felt like, okay, so clearly we can't trust these people to act in good faith with us as we're going through this situation. So they really started to ramp up the threats, and that's when they basically said, it's done, you know, we're going public with this. Mm-hmm. And so on December 8th, 72, Dorothy Hunt had a meeting with Michelle Clark, that journalist who worked for CBS. And Clark was working on a story on the Watergate case. Miss Clark, according to Sherman Skolnick, had lots of insight into the bugging and cover-up through her boyfriend, a CIA operative. Also with Hunt and Clark was Chicago Congressman George Collins. So Dorothy Hunt, Michelle Clark, and George Collins, they take flight 533. I thought it was 553, but I guess it's 533. But anyway, from Washington to Chicago. And it is 553. This is a misprint. But anyway, so they take flight 553 from Washington to Chicago. And the aircraft hit the branches of trees close to Midway Airport. It then hit the roofs of a number of neighborhood bungalows before plowing into the home of some woman and demolishing the home and killing her and her daughter. And the plane then burst into flames, killing a total of 45 people, 43 of them on the plane, including the pilot and first and second officers.
18 18 passengers? Okay, that's what you're about to
say. No. 43 persons died total. 45, I mean. And 43 of them were all on the plane. So two additional people died.
I assumed it was some sort of little private jet or something, but no, that's probably...
No, there were like 60 people.
I think it was probably not a very full commercial jet or something.
No, it was like 50-something people were on the flight. Like at most 55.
Because it seems like all these, you know, plane accidents, these fishy ones are always like private planes, like little planes.
I know.
So this one was just straight up like...
You're going to find this outrageous, dude, because it's... It's so
like Caradori was a private jet. Like that was his private jet.
Yeah, no.
So was Dr. Chumley. And there might be more that come to mind, but yeah.
Oh,
I assumed that they were like all riding in the one little private jet, but no, that would have been, I guess, a little bit more on the nose. This is a little more like, ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But what's insane is that there's too much evidence for it to at all be considered this natural, this, you know, crash happened because of some, like, let's say the pilots are unqualified or some, you know, unfortunate, you know, error in the flight mechanic, whatever it is. Right. But so 43 of them were on the plane, like I said, including the pilot, first and second officers. Now, keep this in mind, man, the pilot, it was discovered that the pilot had four times the amount of cyanide in his system. And I was like, fuck off. Like, it just pissed me off because you remember Patty Hearst, cyanide tip bullets, Jonestown. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? How many things can we point to? It's like a calling card at this point. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of ridiculous to me. But so, yeah, 18 passengers did survive. But here's the crazy thing. It's not only... Like, there are allegations of a CIA hitman on the plane who was going to make sure what took place, right? And so it's very interesting.
What, sure pop, parachute out or something? Like,
no, allegedly, you might have to die for this.
Oh, shit. All right. Yeah. Now that, it's like, I find that a little more implausible unless get into the really crazy somebody that got lied to or MK Ultra or something. So
100%, which, hey, you already know how I feel at this point. I'll say I get done with the psychopath machine and I'm like, what is possible? You know what I mean? But what I do think is that there are some people who are irrationally loyal and fierce, like in their belief systems. And I will tell you, there are people who, you know, like, for example, G. Gordon Liddy himself, I explained him as a maniac. There's nobody involved in any of this that I don't deem some sort of psychopath, honestly, man, like in every aspect of the story, you know. And but Liddy himself was deemed like out of his damn mind, but so fiercely loyal that at this point he was willing to take the blame for everything. And he had told the White House and everyone involved, like, man, if you guys want me to, I'll go stand out on the corner. Just tell me when to do it. And I'll take the bullet for all of this. And it'll all die with me. You know, I mean, that he was that. So anyway, I just think you can never really, like, leave it entirely out of the question is all. You know, you have to at least like consider there are people out there, and not even factoring in the MK Ultra aspects of all of this and the potential reality of Manchurian candidates and things. But yeah, so of course, Hunt, Clark, and Collins were all killed in the accident. And so just before Dorothy Hunt boarded this aircraft, she had purchased $250,000 in flight insurance payable to E. Howard Hunt in his book Undercover in 74. Hunt claims he was unaware that his wife planned to do this. And in the book, he also tried to explain what his wife was doing with $10,000 in her purse. And according to Hunt, it was money to be invested with Hal Carlstead in two already built Holiday Inns in the Chicago area. But the following month, E. Howard Hunt, of course, it was within weeks, he pleads guilty to burglary and wiretapping and throws himself at the mercy of the court. And you have to remember, he was like, they appointed, it's totally crazy what happened, because basically he was being pressured at the time by John Dean and being leveraged, right, to plead guilty. And so he had to initially, the whole thing was you have to drop your CIA defense, right? Ultimately, that was the thing. And the problem is, though, is that Nixon immediately names Butterfield and Eagle Crow to man the investigation, the FAA investigation into the plane crash, right? So the next day, it was like within hours. It, you know, it didn't take long at all. And so although Howard Hunt's pled guilty a month later, eventually serving 33 months in prison, he keeps his silence. Another member of the Watergate team, by James McCord, writes this letter to John Sirica, which we talked about last week. But the airplane crash was blamed initially on equipment malfunction, right? But Carl Oglesby pointed out that the day after the crash, White House aide Eagle Crow was appointed Under Secretary of Transportation, supervising the National Transportation Safety Board and the Federal Aviation Association, the two agencies charged with investigating the airline crash. And a week later, Nixon's deputy assistant, Alexander Butterfield, was made the new head of the FAA. There's a fucking story by Alex Constantine, this investigative journalist that I've used multiple times as a source. He's got some amazing work. It reminds me of McGowan, honestly, in a lot of ways, you know. But he has this story about Butterfield being so deeply involved in the Mamas and the Papas and basically running what's her name? Damn it, I'm forgetting her name, but the girl that ran the Mamas and the Papas, the main singer girl. Damn it.
I never got big into that.
Okay, well, the whole point is that he was deeply involved with the Manson network that was in play at this very moment.
Yeah, I know that they came up a lot in the Manson story.
Yeah, but Nixon actually came out and he had to actually apologize and rescind a statement because it could have affected the trial with Manson, which is just totally interesting. But yeah, anyway, Alexander Butterfield was super involved with that Laurel Canyon scene and what was happening around there at that time. I find that very interesting. Not at all surprising, but the timing of it all is very crazy.
Yeah, it shows you what kind of spooky is. So
exactly. Yeah. 100%, man. So yeah, he's appointed to head the FAA. And so then you have multiple different writers and authors that that suggested that Dorothy Hunt was murdered, of course. And so in 74, even Charles Colson, Howard Hunt's boss and you know, schoolmate at Brown, told Time magazine that I think they killed Dorothy Hunt, right? And Barbara Morris Freed also raised several issues in her article, Flight 553, The Watergate Murder. Freed claimed that Attorney General John Mitchell was under investigation for corruptly helping the El Paso Natural Gas Company against its main competitor, the Northern Natural Gas Company. Mitchell's decision to drop antitrust charges was worth an estimated $300 million to El Paso. Ralph Blodgett and James Krueger, two attorneys working for Northern Natural Gas Company in the investigation of Mitchell, were both killed in the plane crash. Like, I think that, come on, you know, like at this point, especially when you hear what the flight operators on the ground were saying, right? Mm-hmm. So Fried also claims that just hours after the crash, this anonymous phone call was made to the WBBM Chicago CBS talk show. And the caller described himself as a radio ham who had monitored ground control's communication with 553. And he reported an exchange concerning gross control tower error or sabotage. And CBS, the employer of Michelle Clark, they withheld this information from the authorities investigating the accident. So one FBI agent went straight to Midway's control tower and confiscated the tape containing information concerning the crash. The FBI did this before the NTSB could act a unique and illegal intervention. And so Fried also pointed out that FBI agents were at the scene of the crash before the fire department, which received a call within 1 minute of the crash. All right. So yeah. The FBI later claimed that it was only 12 agents that reached the scene of the crash, but then it was later revealed, oh no, there were over 50 agents searching through the wreckage. Like, my God, man, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, which is a commonality in a lot of these events. Like Oklahoma City, that's like there's a lot of people who made claims that, like, how fishy it was, how many of the federal agents showed up as quickly 100%. As they did. And you're like, what the fuck? Like, dude. Like Yiki, that was in his letter. He made some kind of like this, you know, alluding to like what the fuck. And he was supposedly, you know, all things I've seen is that he was the first guy that got there. And then like within like he remarked that's still so that like, how the fuck are these guys here? I mean, saying he's the first is hard because like when I had Vassar on, he did kind of go into like because we were trying to nail down that claim. And it's like I do think it was like where the building was so big and there was different sides. So you'd like. I mean, obviously, you're not an omnipresent individual, so if you're there and there's smoke everywhere, I mean, but that seems to be most people point 100%. To Yiki being, like, one of, if not the first, and even he's like, dude, what the fuck? Like,
how are these guys already here?
Yeah. So I don't know if he, like, I don't think, he definitely didn't say that they were already there, but he said, like, the quickness with which they were there was,
there
like,
were a lot of reports about that, though. Yeah. Just a lot. You know, and not
and they may have already been there when Terry was there and just he hadn't seen him yet.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. And many more people than just Terry said that, you know, that's so it's like feels corroborated in many ways as far as witness accounts, at the very least.
It's
something that I always kind of thought to be true. You know what I mean? But not at all would it surprise me. But I grabbed this because a long time ago, I made a note that Michael Stevens. All right. Stevens Research Laboratories, all right, he sold the bugging devices to James McCord, discovered during the Watergate. And he told the FBI that Dorothy Hunt was flying to Chicago to see him in order to ensure his silence with a cash payment. And she then claimed, Stevens claimed to the FBI that he was threatened just after the crash by persons unknown who claimed that Dorothy Hunt's death was a homicide and that he would be next in line if he ever talked. So I'm just saying, like, that is the guy. His company for sure is the one that McCord tapped for the bugging devices and to wiretap the DNC. So if it's just another example, right, and another account of that effectively just being a complete and total fabrication, you know what I mean? Like, obviously Dorothy was murdered, right? Yeah. I mean, at this point, I don't even think there's a debate when it comes to that. And especially when you find out that, you know, I mean, beyond the FBI's appearance at the crash site, and there's another proponent of these theories involving Dorothy and the plane crash being involved with Watergate. And it's Sherman Skolnick, the same author who he's a Chicago-based private investigator, though, you know, so it's like you know, he's writing things, but he's doing real investigation, you know, and it, do what, you know, take this for what you want. But, and he's been dismissed by, let's say, the Washington Post, you know what I mean? But still, like, to me, his story checks out. And he alleged that the aircraft had 100% been sabotaged by the CIA. And on June 13th in 73, Skolnick testified at a hearing in Rosemont, Illinois, and claimed the Federal Bureau of Investigation, Columbia Broadcasting System, CBS, United Airlines, traffic controllers at Midway, and the NTSB itself, which were the ones controlling the hearings, conspired to plot to sabotage the flight because 12 of its passengers had links to Watergate. Damn. You know, and United Airlines officials had asked the NTSB to hear Skolnick's version because he had frequently charged that UAL was among those attempting to suppress his explanation of events. And he said that Hunt carried $2 million in traveler's checks and money orders stolen from the Committee for the Reelection of the President, $50,000 in currency, and documents that may have led to the impeachment of President Richard Nixon, which I believe to be the JFK documents. Mm-hmm. He stated also that a hitman whom Nixon had placed aboard the aircraft to make sure that Hunt was killed also died in the crash. So I don't know if he, you know, hey, this you might have to die for the, who knows, right?
Yeah.
Not entirely sure, but still worth mentioning, I felt, you know what I mean? And, mm-hmm. and so we'll get to what I think will lead us into really the most important parts of this story.
Yeah.
But I want
real,
to...
Real quick, I do want to point out, we are... I'm going to go ahead and let the audience know already. I think there will be another part.
I'm sorry, brother.
You're good. It's perfectly fine. It's okay. I'm just kind of gauging where we're at because I kind of know a rough idea of where we're bringing this. But I'm already telling the now that I'm like, we probably have one more thread to tug on a little bit in this episode. Maybe leave it with like a... this and the next one being the final one, because there's a lot more that we have to unpack for sure. Yeah. And I know we're not going to get that done in under an hour probably. No, so, but I don't know. I mean, I guess you're kind of leading to something, but I don't know if there's another thread you want to tug on before we get to the final thread, but it's like how we spent like 30 minutes on a plane crash and that's big shit already.
I know. I'm sorry, brother.
No, you're fine. You're fine. That's good. That's good. I'm not complaining, okay. But okay. I'm just saying like, this is the level that we're at. We're like this type of shit happening and it gets even darker in our next episode.
Crazy,
but
dude.
I mean, maybe we'll get into a little bit of that now. I don't know what thread you want to tug on. I believe.
Yeah,
one
no,
of them, go ahead.
We'll at least transition into the call girl operation because we have to. But yeah. I think that Hunt's timeline is so important to understand. Mm-hmm. And like I've been saying, his initial CIA defense, that in itself is very important to grasp because he, like I mentioned, had these CIA operational diaries that they go missing when he's blackmailing Nixon. And it was ordered to be destroyed by John Dean and Jeb Magruder. They officially destroyed the contents within Howard Hunt's safe. And that included his operational diary for the CIA. And I think that was all in order to help bolster the CIA's secret agenda of making sure they deflect away from CIA involvement to White House obstruction. This is solely White House. They ordered the break-in for this reason, everyone. Larry O'Brien's desk, DNC dirt, you know? So the contents of the safe destroyed. Dorothy Hunt's murder. McCord refuses to cooperate. He's not going along with Howard Hunt's version any longer. As far as, even to begin with, he was, like I said, whispering to the judge. He wasn't really willing to go public with anything, right? And I think it's due to a very special relationship McCord has with Richard Helms, which, I don't know, man. I'm just saying, like, everybody's gay. So, and then, of course, like I mentioned, Hunt gives into the pressure being leveraged by Dean and Magruder and the White House and subsequently pleads guilty, dropping his initial CIA defense. And then an appeals court rules this is important, that the prosecution could not ask wiretap monitor Alfred Baldwin III what was overheard on the tapes. And so that effectively renders the blackmail angle dead, right? No longer is sexual blackmail on the table as a potential motivation for the break-in. And that's all that had to happen, right? As far as within the context of the trial. And so mentioning Dean and McCord's role in fulfilling the CIA cover-up, McCord, like I had said, he enters the picture because Helms is basically Helms and the agency. They need someone to dupe Liddy while operating under deep cover. It would be McCord who would basically, he would help to convince Liddy that the operation went as planned for the committee to reelect the president. Right. And so while simultaneously directing the op toward the secret agenda of achieving the CIA's true objective, which is, by the way, McCord's role here, tap Spencer Oliver Jr.'s phone while pretending to place a room bug in O'Brien's office. That's really what basically happened during the second break-in, because remember, in May, everything goes as planned, smooth as hell operation. But guess what? They got nothing worthwhile. And basically, all they got were the Cubans took, they spread out documents that showed Larry O'Brien's name and the DNC. So it was basically just proof, positive, that, yeah, we're here for this reason, which in reality seems to be, of course, propping up the secret agenda, because Liddy's like, what the fuck is this? Like, this is worthless. You know what I mean? But then he's like, but why would we even break in again? Like, we didn't get shit last time. And that's what I think is crazy, because Hunt and Liddy are like, they're super surprised to find out about this second break-in and the plans for the second break-in, which they find out, somebody tells them it's allegedly June 12th when they find out about this. Mm-hmm. And it's the 17th is the break-in, right? And so, and Hunt and Liddy were the two individuals who are voicing this adamant opposition, and particularly Hunt, because he individually perfectly understood that the CIA had already achieved its goal with the White House approval of wiretapping prostitutes. That's really what was going on. And so the second burglary would be nothing but risk. Like, it just made no sense to him, right? And that makes perfect sense to me, because I think McCord was truly the operator on Helms' behalf. Mm-hmm. Again, we've mentioned layered operation, brother, right? So I believe that, yeah, Howard Hunt knows most of what the plan is, but I think he's being hung out to dry, you know, and that is effectively what happens. And so anyway,
so do you want to lead into this call girl operation a little bit, or is there anything else you want to do? That's like, that's a good cliffhanger. We can probably find some spot to stop it before we get too deep. Yeah,
we are basically transitioning, because one potential motive is this domestic CIA operation or program that's running active surveillance on the Hooker referral pipeline set up through the DNC, right? So I think we're pretty much there. I have just like two notes left on McCord, because I think his role is just so important here. And so McCord chooses the side of the agency, right? And Hunt's left out to dry. And so Penny Gleason is this assistant security officer at the CRP for McCord. She, like, legitimately McCord. Penny Gleason is the name, and it's McCord's assistant security officer at the CRP who was questioned by the FBI 2 weeks after McCord's arrest. And it was she was questioned on July 1st. And McCord had in his office a photograph of CIA Director Richard Helms, signed by Richard Helms, with a note to McCord that read, "With deep appreciation, Dick." And deep was underlined twice. And I know this is pure speculation, but perhaps a not so subtle nod to McCord operating under deep cover. Yeah. You know, I mean, like, honestly, it could be.
And I mean, could I know that be a reference to Deep Throat of some sort, or would that make sense in the time frame?
I mean, I think honestly, he had it.
Maybe my perverted mind, deep dick, deep throat. Right. And I'm like, is he making a dirty joke? And like, kind of like, hey, you know, kind of like a wink, like, what's up? Like,
very possible because this picture, of course, goes conveniently and suspiciously missing. It's removed from McCord's office by his loyal assistant, Robert Houston, shortly after the arrest. And Robert Houston is from, I think, episode one or two, when we talked about the Houston plan, the covert operation to infiltrate the White House and get domestic approval for White House approval for domestic operations. It's just crazy, man. And so then the Nixon-Helms war, right? Which this is what we all need to understand, all right, is that there was for sure an all-out war between Nixon and Helms by this time, all right? And there's proof of it at this point because in December of 72, so McCord sends this letter to the White House detective John Caulfield, warning him that if CIA Director Helms was removed from his position as director, every tree in the forest will fall. I said that last episode, but Nixon then forces Helms to resign 2 months later on February 2nd in 73. So then March 19th, all right, not very long after that, James McCord sends a letter that was read aloud in open court. And we mentioned this last episode too, but according to McCord's letter, this changes the whole scope of everything because everyone's already been charged. This, you know what I mean? Like at this point, this is going to obstruct the entire trial and the scope of it all, right? Like, and so McCord sends this letter. And according to the letter, there had been perjury committed in the trial. He also wrote that the White House had both threatened him and offered him clemency in an effort to falsely blame the CIA for the break-in. That's what McCord says, right? It does that not provide like the perfect false narrative to completely distract away and also, you know, completely reject any sort of notion that the CIA had any involvement whatsoever and this wasn't solely a White House operation? And so this letter quickly becomes the center of attention. The Washington Post is, it won't shut the fuck up, and further discredits the CIA involvement narrative. And this, of course, is the perfect moment for John Dean to subsequently turn prosecution key witness following McCord's bombshell letter. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. But he's the hero, everyone, right? He's the hero of Watergate, the conflicted attorney, the young White House counsel that just feels he has to do it what's within his moral obligation and resist Nixon. You know, like, how crazy is that narrative? Mm-hmm. And so then after this bombshell letter, like I said, prosecution.
Especially when we dig into who he is, which we will. Oh, but dude. Which I think we have a little bit, but we're going to get there. We're going.
Yeah, directly where we're going. So he proceeds to falsely incriminate Attorney General John Mitchell as the primary perpetrator who ordered the break-in, officially tying Watergate in as a White House operation with White House approval for the break-in. And of course, then later on, when asked by the senator from Hawaii why he would be so willing to violate the law, James McCord shares a revealing statement. He says that he believed the operation was legal because it was authorized by the Attorney General as a national security operation, again confirming the theory of CIA involvement and infiltration of the White House and CRP. So, fuck James McCord. You know what I mean? Like, my God, man. So, well, and especially when Hunt and Magruder are both like, and Jeb Magruder, he didn't have, you know, they both claim, Hunt and Magruder, that it was John Dean who ordered the second break-in, right? Mm-hmm. And the target, this is allegedly to Magruder because he didn't know officially. The target was the dirt the Dems might have had on the Republicans. And this is what Magruder told to Libby. But Liddy just assumed that that meant Larry O'Brien's desk was the target, right? And so, again, they're not read in on the secret agenda. And so this is where Yeah, this is where we should transition. I think it's the perfect moment because you have, like, I had Douglas Caddy, I had mentioned as the attorney. Yeah. And again, his fucking background is insane because you find out that he knows Guy Bannister. He's from New Orleans, where he grew up and got his political start while in high school. And then worked out of Guy Bannister's office, the same place that Lee Harvey Oswald would work in, but leading up to the JFK assassination. He also worked in Governor Rockefeller's office during the JFK's assassination. He's got an insane story. He was a secret homosexual, and for a long time.
Implications of all that.
Telling you, man.
Also, the insinuations that you can be like, what the 100%? Fuck?
Yeah, especially when you find out that Douglas Caddy is personally friends with Howard Hunt and is employed by Mullen and Company, right? Yeah.
Well, you're talking about Oswald, and it's like, it reminds me, I don't know, I mean, I doubt this guy was in with Ferry's unit, but like, obviously with Ferry's unit, they had Oswald and who else was in there? I think there were some other big names that were
Barry
in that.
Barry Seal, dude.
Barry Seal. I think there were some other, there were some other people, but it was like, it's heavily implied when you dig into Ferry's story and then the cadre of boys he kept around him, that it's something darker was going on. And so then now you add, and especially what we're going to get into definitely more next episode, then now having this young kid that got involved in politics and worked his way up, it's kind of like, what pipeline did you go through?
That's what I'm saying. Like, how is this possible, man?
Yeah, like, but what the fuck happened to you, man?
For real. Like, for real. And especially, like, he's got an insane story. He wrote this really amazing, like, memoir basically about the entire situation. And then he also wrote this, he knows this Carl Schaffler, the arresting officer. Robert Merritt was his informant, was Carl Schaffler's informant. All right. He wrote a book about all of this, and we're going to get into that too, but it implicates all of these people. And it really ties it all together. It's amazing because Doug Caddy, man, just none of this is coincidental. I'm sorry, man. Like, I just don't believe that they lied to you and you were under the false impression that it wasn't a CIA front company until later. But who knows? He 100% admits that he knew that Howard Hunt was CIA. So it's strange. But what he says is, and this is just a brief beginning to his this short little story that he wrote about being the original attorney for the Watergate 7. And it just perfectly outlines that, first of all, these are Howard Hunt's words. From there, I drove to the White House annex, the old executive office building from the Howard Johnson's hotel, after running across to meet with the wiretap monitor, Alfred Baldwin III, in room 719. He tells him, get all this shit that McCord and you rigged up in this fucking hotel and grab the gemstone file and get it to McCord's house. I don't care if you drive the van into the river. I don't give a shit. That's what he said, right? Just get it out of here. And so then he claims after that, he drives to the White House annex, the old executive office building in bygone years, the War Department, and later the Department of State. Carrying three heavy attaché cases, I entered the Pennsylvania Avenue door, showed my blue and white White House pass to the uniformed guards, and took the elevator to the third floor. I unlocked the door of 338 and went in. I opened my two-drawer safe, took out my operational handbook, found a telephone number, and dialed it. The time was 2:13 in the morning of June 17th, 1972. And five of my companions had been arrested and taken to the maximum security block of the District of Columbia Jail. I had recruited four of them, and it was my responsibility to get them out. This was the sole focus of my thoughts as I began talking on the telephone. But with those five arrests, the Watergate affair had begun. After several rings, the call was answered, and I heard the sleepy voice of Douglas Caddy. Yes? Doug? This is Howard, and I hate to wake you up, but I've got a tough situation, and I need to talk to you. Can I come over? Sure, I'll tell the desk clerk you're expected. I'll be there in about 20 minutes, I told him, and I hung up. From the safe, I took a small money box and removed $10,000 Liddy had given me for emergency use. I put $1,500 in my wallet and the remaining $8,500 in my coat pocket. The black attaché case containing McCord's electronic equipment I placed in a safe drawer that held my operational notebook. Then I closed and locked the safe, turned the dial several times. The other two cases I left beside the safe. Turned out the light and left my office locking the door. That's in E. Howard Hunt's memoir, Undercover, Memoirs of an American Secret Agent. So Howard, this is according to Douglas Caddy. Howard Hunt accurately describes how I got involved in his attorney in what as his attorney in Watergate within hours after the burglars were arrested. Yet to my mind, my entry in the case began indirectly 2 months earlier in April 72, when I was called into the office of John Kilcullen, a partner in the Washington law firm of Gal, Lane, Powell, and Kilcullen, where I worked. Kilcullen, a loyal Republican, as was I, declared, Doug our firm, or no, shit, sorry. This is a quote from Kilcullen, a loyal Republican, and as was Doug Caddy. Doug, our firm has been asked to volunteer an attorney to work for the Lawyers Committee for the re-election of the president, and you are being volunteered. Call George Webster, the committee's chairman, and get your assignment. So I called Webster, who told me to report to John Dean, counsel to the president. Dude, it's like this. He's already personal friends with Howard Hunt, brother. Like, it just like, come on. I don't know. It seems crazy to me, but during my first meeting with John Dean in his White House office, shown on his appointment calendar as April 25th, he gave me my first assignment. This was to research contributions to candidates for the Democratic presidential nomination, one of whom was certain to oppose Richard Nixon in the November election. Over the next 2 months, Dean gave me additional run-of-the-mill assignments. The last one that his office gave me took me to syndicated columnist Jack Anderson to get any background information Anderson might have not used in a recent newspaper column he wrote about Democratic Senator Edmund Muskie, one of the presidential contenders. This was on the day before the arrest of the burglars at Watergate. The significance of my doing volunteer work under the direction of John Dean, beginning in April 72, will become apparent as I relate here how Watergate evolved in the first weeks of the case and how the ultimate outcome of the case could and should have been vastly different, but for Dean. This will include Dean selecting me to be the first person approached to pass hush money to the five arrested burglars and to Hunt and Gordon Liddy, and my refusal to do so. Dean withholding vital information from President Nixon, as shown by the Oval Office tapes of July 19th and 20th, 72, about my campaign volunteer work under Dean's direction and his attempt to get me to distribute the hush money. This untold story of Watergate is essential history, because the entire case could have been resolved in the first month or so had it not been for Dean devising a secret agenda for his own purpose to protect himself from the legal consequences of certain of his activities prior to Watergate, even if ultimately it meant the betrayal of President Nixon and of the nation. So that was all I wanted to mention about that, because I think it's a perfect little segue and introduction to Douglas Caddy. That way you realize who we're talking about when we discuss Douglas Caddy from here forward, because he is a very key character within a lot of this and kind of draws very bold, strange connections that you can't make sense of unless you kind of are under the impression of the theory that I kind of hold to be true. And yeah. And so, yeah, I think that that's really the perfect moment, though.
If you want, we can leave it there. And then next week we'll get into the boy sex rings and all that fun stuff.
White House call girl.
Yeah, the call girls. And you go down that dark road where that spiral us down to, which will get pretty fucking dark. Austin, let people know where they can find you, and we'll get out of here, and we'll do another one of these here soon.
Sounds good, brother. You guys just check out the podcast. Well, first, subscribe to the YouTube. We can get those numbers, keep going up, and then
Yeah, for real. I do want to say, because our already dead streams to both, and I would like to be able to get super chats on YouTube. You can super 100%. Chat me on Rumble, but not as many people use Rumble. And so I would like to add that feature to the show. And so if you guys follow Austin, we can get him monetized. Although he'll probably get demonetized shortly after, but whatever. Hey, whatever. That. Small window. We can make something happen.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. yeah. So just follow the podcast at the Underclass Podcast. Pretty much you can find it anywhere. And follow me at Underclass Pod on Twitter, at the Underclass Podcast on Instagram, and support me on Buzzsprout and Patreon for sure.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you coming on. We'll do this again soon. I'll see you on Tuesday as well. But I do want to let you guys know, if you want to support me, there's a number of ways you can do it. You can like, share, subscribe, comment, all that good stuff. Share this stuff around, edit, stuff like that. That helps out. But if you do want to give me money, I like that. It's patreon.com/nowayjose2020. The lowest level is $2. That gives you early episodes for the non-live stream stuff. So that usually that'll be about, that's like every other episode, and that's usually about a week, you get it earlier. And then you can be a talking head on our show, Already Dead. You can come on as a talking head like we are right now. Also I do want to give shout out. I do this every episode for the highest level, my patron sponsors, and that's my co-host on Tower Gang at Tower Gang Toad. I also have at Abrogate D's, at ZOVERACK, then at _infinite zeal, and Jacob Daniel of the Biblical Anarchy Podcast. You can follow him at Biblical Anarchy. Tim Tuttle at Jolly on Klebold. He's where we got that edit for, which I thought we were going to get the darker stuff, so that edit made more sense this episode, but whatever. It'll make more sense for next episode. So if you want to break down all the symbolism that was in there. Then also
love that edit, though.
Yeah, it's a good edit, but it'll make more sense for next week's episode. And then also, Will Bell. He has this delicious Rabbit Eye blueberry wine. I highly recommend you get it if you do like to partake of the alcohol. Yeah, he has got that online. You can go get that. But I appreciate you guys that support me. You guys are the real ones. And with that, we are out.